Good morning, everybody. Welcome today to Lake Forest Church. It's good to be here with you. My name is Harrison. Let's stand to our feet together today as we get ready to get started. We're going to sing a song that we learned last week. It's from Psalm 22 that says, "You inhabit the praises of your people." So what that means for us today is that as we sing, as we worship, as we sing the truth of who God is, that His Spirit is in this place with us as we gather and as we sing. So let's welcome Him as we worship Him this morning. Let's sing.
And our praise becomes your house, your place. Our praise becomes your house, your place. Keep singing that. Our praise becomes your house, your place.
Yeah.
Our praise becomes your house.
Let's ask God to do a new thing in us this morning. Let's sing it. We sing a song.
We sing a song and you come. Make a dance and you come. Shout your name and you come. Give you praise and you come. We sing a song and you come. Make a dance and you come. Shout your name and you come. Give you praise and you come. We sing a song and you come. Make a dance.
Circumstances, he said, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. Let's stand on his promises as we sing, you're never gonna let me down. Let's sing.
Gonna let me down.
We are yours.
Be yours.
God, we worship you. As we see the truth of who you are, God, we feel compelled to sing of your greatness and your goodness in our lives. We come from a place of thankfulness because of who you are and what you've done. We worship you because you are good, and we are thankful. In Jesus' name, amen. You can have a seat.
Well, good morning and welcome again to Lake Forest Church, Huntersville. If we haven't met yet, my name is Susan Arrington. I'm on staff here on the team in communications. We're so glad you joined us this morning. Believe it or not, it's the last Sunday in January. I feel like I was just up here like a minute ago talking about getting ready for Christmas Eve, and we're already halfway through the month. I hope that your 2020 is off to a great start. If this is your first time at Lake Forest, we especially want to welcome you. We hope you'll find that this is a safe and encouraging place where you can discover and live out your role in God's story. We always say, as long as you don't have it all together, you'll fit in here with the rest of us. On this card that you received when you came in today, there's information inside about how to take some next steps at Lake Forest, how to join us on social media. One of our classes, our best next step, is Welcome 101. There's a couple more sessions coming up for that this winter. The dates and times are up here, and you can learn more about that class and get registered at lakeforest.org/classes. Another thing that you can do on this card on the back is let us know how we can join you in prayer this week. We're a community that prays. We know that God is listening. We have a dedicated team of folks who would love to pray for you this week. So write down whatever you're carrying on your heart today for yourself or someone you care about. In a little while, we're going to pass around a jeans pocket, and you can tear off that portion of the card and drop it right in there. The jeans pocket is also one of the ways that those of us who call Lake Forest home give back to God in worship with our tithes and offering. Lake Forest, we always say that you're such a generous church, and we mean that. And Pastor Mitch is going to come up in just a little bit and share about how generous you were in 2019. So thank you in advance. Before we get to that, though, I want to tell you about some things happening at LFC beyond Sunday morning. Last week, we told you that we're kind of throwing together quickly a mission trip to Abaco in the Bahamas. Of course, the island was devastated this fall by Hurricane Dorian. We came together with financial relief for the island and prayers, and now it's finally time and safe for us to send a team there to go. So this is a quick little mission trip, 4 days of work and 2 days of travel. If you've never been on a mission trip at Lake Forest before, this may be your time to go. Or if you already know that you love the people of the Bahamas and you'd love to help restore that island, this is a great opportunity for you to go as well. The deadline is coming up quick. It's this coming weekend. You can learn more about the trip and apply at lakeforest.org/trips. Men, we want to let you know that your quarterly men's breakfast is coming up in a couple of weeks. These breakfasts are always a great time for you to catch up with old friends, make some new connections. There's a guest speaker. We're having Major General Chuck Swanak. I hope that's how you say his name. He actually used to command the 82nd Airborne. He's going to be coming to share about his life and how God got a hold of him and how faith was active in his life in his 30-plus year military career. As always, feel free to invite your friends and neighbors to come along with that. Bring your sons. We just ask that you RSVP at lakeforest.org/events, so there's plenty of food for you. Next Sunday is, of course, the Super Bowl, but it's also going to be the Super Bowl here because our Remix youth are collecting soup cans, and we're going to be collecting those for Second Harvest Food Bank. So if you come to worship next week, bring a can of soup or two. Remix youth will be collecting that. Also, Remixers, don't forget that after the second service, next week is your annual Chili Bowl. So there'll be football on the lawn and chili and trivia and all that kind of fun stuff going on as well. Looking forward to that. Okay, Pastor Mitch, are you ready?
Yeah.
All right.
I thought your transition was, speaking of super. Good thing there's not a third service, huh? So, good morning, folks. My name is Mitch. I'm the executive pastor of Lake Forest, if I've not gotten to meet you, and I get to do a few things. One is sometimes I get to come and preach and convict you of your sin, and then there are other times that I get to come and give you one of my responsibilities is overseeing our finances of all of our churches, and One of the things we did a number of months ago is we sent out a survey to all of our ministry partners just saying, what would help us learn a little bit more about how you hear us talking about stewardship? And one of the things that we heard was that a number of you said, well, we'd love to just get more regular updates on how we are and what we spend our money on and things like that. So we're going to try and find more opportunity to do that and just giving you more detailed reports. In a few weeks, we're in the middle of doing a financial audit of all of our 2019 finances. We want to be accountable to those. In a few weeks, we're going to send out to you, I'll give you a good detailed report of that, but also all the things that have happened with the money that you've been so generous in giving this year in 2019. But before, so you're going to receive that, but I wanted to give you just a snapshot and some things to really celebrate for us. So here in Huntersville, the ministry and mission focus and the money, that's this money that's spent on personnel, missions, benevolence, all of our ministry expenses and things like that. Our planned initiatives was $2,122,000. Your generosity was $2,194,000 for 2019. Celebrate that. That is just amazing to be able to know that we can go through the year and do the things that God has called us as a church to do. Now, in March of 2017, for those of you that were here, we did an initiative, a thing called Immeasurably More. And Immeasurably More was trying to make more room for more people to come and to be a part of Lake Forest and to hear about God's love. Now, a lot of you were not here in 2017, but you are able to have a seat here and to be a part of ministry here because of the folks who were here in 2017 and their giving. So we're excited about, we had a three-year campaign in focus that ends in March of this year, 2020. The goal was $4,026,000. At the end of December 31st, 2019, $3,373,824 has been given. And so we've got $652,000 to go. We're on target to doing that. So those of you who've committed to being a part of that, would you just continue to faithfully give? If you've come since 2017, we invite you, help us finish this on time. And would you consider as well giving to our Immeasurably More fund as well? The other part is I want you to hear this. This is the most exciting. It's not just about the money that comes in. It's about what is able to happen from that. Because of this giving, we were able to increase our parking by 40%, and our parking lot is filling up, and that means people are coming. We were able to double our kids' space, the lobby. We opened our building 7 days a week, not just for Sunday, but 7 days a week. Now, here's some fun stuff to know about that. The Learning Tree, our preschool, we just finished one full calendar year in caring for over 150 kids. Out of that, we were able to help 32% of the kids who came, those families, with financial assistance. We were able to give scholarships of $55,000 for families to be able to come. That is awesome. We don't want to just be another Lake Norman preschool. We want to really reach folks who can't afford necessarily to put their kids in a preschool. Our goal for 2020 is giving away $82,000, and the ability to do that is in place. Define Coffee, our coffee shop. It averages 115 new people who walk in here every single week. Can you believe that? That is so fun to see. We actually, because of that space, we're able to host about, fit on average, on a monthly basis, we're able to host about 50 non-Lake Forest events that come into this building. That's serving the community, and that's averaging of those events each month is averaging about 700 people who come in from outside of Lake Forest to be a part of that. The space is getting used. It's also, the biggest part is it's helping this community to really trust the church again. Here's the other thing. How does that affect our worship time? Easter of 2017, 2,111 people worshiped here. Easter 2019, 2,579 people. Christmas 2017, 2,802 people. Christmas 2019, 3,102 people worshiped here. Now, 3,000 of those were at the 3 o'clock service because we told you the 4:30 service was too full, and you heard us. We're going to figure that out. But here's the cool thing is over 3,000 people have been worshiping here on that. So you're going to see in this report that I sent out, you're going to see a lot of the details of those things. The other thing I want you to know is your staff have been very diligent in spending what has been budgeted. And so they've been very good and disciplined in being right at what we targeted. But here's a bigger part that I want you, Huntersville, to understand. Lake Forest Church Huntersville is 21 years old. Over the 21 years, we've been able to plant three other churches, okay? Out of those churches, the work that's happened there, the ministry and mission generosity, the giving of all of our churches as a family, $4,274,000. The giving to the new initiatives, this is immeasurably more. Davidson also has done a campaign called Root It. That's another $2,354,300. On top of that, you gave to hurricane relief in the Bahamas. You've adopted orphans in Bolivia, Honduras. Your generosity is amazing. In Asia, kids, Haiti, we've cared for folks right here with benevolence. In 2019, almost $7 million has gone out of Lake Forest Church to serve people. Because of that, in some way, in some fashion, right here, just in the doors of Lake Forest Church, Huntersville, you have told and you have showed God's love to an estimated 13,500 people who have walked through these doors in 2019 in some way and have heard about God's love for them, and you've loved them as they discover and live out God's role in their story. Folks, you have a lot to celebrate. This is an impact for years to come. So I want to invite, would you all stand? We are today continuing this story of looking at David, and I'm going to pray David's prayer over you, 1 Chronicles 29, this is what Pastor Mike's going to look at today. But I want to, for word, just pray exactly what David prayed for us as a congregation. So would you bow your heads and hear these words of David and take them on as your own. But who am I, Lord, who am I and who are these people that we should be able to give as generously as this? Everything comes from you, and we have given you only what comes from your hand. We are foreigners and strangers in your sight, as were all our ancestors. Our days on earth are like a shadow without hope. But Lord our God, all this abundance that we have provided for building you a temple for your holy name comes from your hand, and all of it belongs to you. I know, my God, that you test the heart and are pleased with integrity. All these things I've given willingly and with honest intent, and now I have seen with joy how willingly your people who are here have given to you. Lord, the God of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, keep these desires and thoughts in the hearts of your people forever. Keep their hearts loyal to you. In the name of Jesus, we praise this. Amen. Would you just turn to one another, introduce yourself, and high-five each other, saying, well done.
You may be seated. I'm Mike Moses. I'm lead pastor here. And thank you for that, Mitch. You know, this is a cool thing. Mitch and I have been around and leading the church together since it was founded 21 years ago. What a joy and privilege that he and I have been able to. Yeah. And with a whole bunch of you guys, too. But it is a joy and a unique thing that he and I have been able to partner together. He's a pretty good dude most of the time. We're gonna finish our sermon series. Our sermon series for January is called Start. We've been learning different ways of starting in our life from the life of King David in the Old Testament. In keeping with what Mitch just brought us in that update, we're going to look at David starting a legacy and how he treated finances and generosity. We'll just go with that theme. What Mitch said is just, it's just remarkable, the generosity of this group of people. It's an honor. It's an honor to serve with you. It's an honor for Angie and I to be generous with you and just a part of it. It really is. And you're so, and so I just want to kind of go with this, and I'm so overwhelmed. I feel a prophecy coming on. I think I'm going to get charismatic today. I'm hearing something from the Lord, and I'm trying to locate it. And Dave, I think maybe it's you. Like, you guys are so generous, but Dave, I think I'm hearing from the Lord that not only on top of your ongoing generosity, I'm pretty sure I'm hearing from the Lord that you're going to give everything away in generosity. Just like the, wait. It's not just you. Wait a minute. It's Charlie, too. The Lord's doing, as generous as you are, I think I'm hearing, dude, you're just going to give it all away. No, it's not just you, too. It's the whole balcony. I'm hearing this from the Lord. You're going to give everything away because God has decided all the stuff you have, car you drove here in, place where you live, where you rent or you own, your storage unit, your second storage unit. God has decided that when it comes time for you to leave this earth, that's going to all go to somebody else. Because the Lord God says, in the new heavens and the new earth, I got better stuff for you. So you don't need that. So ultimately, every person in this room, we are going to give it all to someone. It will go to someone else. And yet, in spite of the fact that we'll all be the ultimate givers, we'll all ultimately give it all, there's many of us in this life who aren't getting in on the joy of it now. Who are like, really? Like, giving a lot of money to people on the other side of the world that I'll probably never meet? When we got problems here, really giving generously here to help educate the children of recent immigrants who give them a leg up, seriously giving that kind of money to the church? I mean, there must be somebody in here who stroked a big check, but seriously, that kind of money, I don't know, tithing? I don't know about that. There's a lot of us, in spite of the massive generosity in these people, and those of you worshiping with us online today, there's a lot of us, though, still, our approach to giving is like, how little could I give and still consider myself a generous person? Or how little could I do? I have to give and kind of have God happy with me, or think of myself as a spiritual person, because I know whether I'm looking into Christianity or even other spiritualities, like, generosity is a part of being a spiritual person. But how little can I give and consider myself that God probably smiles at me? And why is that? Even though this is a thing many of us wrestle with, but especially because even personal experience and social science proves that generous people are happy people. They're joyful. Do you know, I just have the privilege of people sometimes telling me how generous they are. And like, those are happy people. I've never met a generous person who got that kind of a face on them. I haven't. And we also know from experience in social science, the opposite is true. The stingy people, greedy people, are unhappy, puckered up, spirited kind of people. Like, that's a sucky way to live. Excuse my French. At this church, we talk about life as it is because the Bible does, and so that's just real. That's just like actually true. Stingy, greedy people are just have a puckered up spirit. Like, I want joy. I want the joy that generosity brings. I don't want the other. One guy has a theory. C.S. Lewis wrote a little book called Screwtape Letters. The Screwtape Letters is a fiction book of letters of a senior demon writing to a junior demon. And it's all made up, and the senior demon is training the junior demon in ways of deception so he can destroy people's lives so that their lives will be more sucky. That's demons' jobs. And here's what he writes to him about the subject of stuff and giving. Quote, the sense of ownership in general, one demon to another, is the sense of ownership in general is always to be encouraged. Those humans are always putting up claims to ownership, which sound equally funny in heaven and in hell. We must keep them doing so. All the time, the joke is that the word mine in a fully possessive sense cannot be uttered by a human being about anything. In the long run, our father, says the demon, meaning the devil, or the enemy, which he means God, will say mine of each thing that exists and especially of each man or woman. They will find out in the end, never fear, to whom their time and their souls and their things really belong, but it is certainly not to them. His point's well taken, that when we claim ownership as human beings over anything, from the perspective of heaven and time, it sounds kind of silly. This is mine, I can control it, do with this what I want because it belongs to me, is kind of silly. Because everything we have somehow was given to us, and we'll pass it on. And yet, I'm just like you. Like, I'm entering a phase of life where I'm like, man, I hope there's enough one day that I could, like, retire and kick back when I'm 95 years old or something. You know, I mean, I'm thinking, like, I need some stuff that's mine. I live with a sense of ownership. I tend to think in my head about my stuff the way the seagulls in the movie Finding Nemo did. All right, what did those seagulls say? We're going to look at a story about King David and the people of Israel. And they were able to explode a huge myth, the myth of ownership, that we are owners in this life in a way that freed them up to do something remarkable, so remarkable, we still talk about it today. And if you want to turn in your own Bible, we're going to be in 1 Chronicles 29. I'm sure you were just reading there this morning. And I'm going to give you a little context as you turn to 1 Chronicles 29. This is King David. We've been learning from him all month, and now he's at the end of his life. He's at the legacy time of life, which will resonate with some of you here. And the people are the people of Israel. And big picture, when we read in the Old Testament about the people of Israel, God has elected a people through whom he is revealing his character and his salvation plan, which will culminate in the suffering servant of Israel, the representative man of Israel, Jesus, the Messiah, who will come and be God's plan to save us through his atoning death on the cross and his resurrection from the dead 3 days later. That's the big plan God's slowly revealing through Israel. And through David now, he's formed them into the people of God, and they're learning about God. And as you know, in the Old Testament, from their perspective, God kind of lived in a box. When they were walking around the desert, the people of Israel, what was the name of the box that God lived in for them? The Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant. And for those of you who saw Raiders of the Lost Ark, what was inside of the Ark of the Covenant? The Ten Commandments. Yes, you did your homework back in the 80s. Ten Commandments. And then they kept the Ark of the Covenant in a tent. And what was that tent called? The Tabernacle. The Tabernacle. We didn't do so great on our pop quiz this morning. The Tabernacle. Here's what's happened now. But by the time we get to 1 Chronicles here, 29, God through David has built this incredible people of Israel, and they're beginning to really know Yahweh and begin to reflect him to the world. And they're now anchored in the capital city of Jerusalem under David's leadership. That has just happened recently. And David is now an older man now. And in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 2, he's like, dude, here I am living in this place. We built a palace, by the way. Angie and I toured the ruins of the palace of King David in ancient Jerusalem. And I'm in this palace. It's got carved wood, cut stone. And he says, here I am living in a house of cedar while the ark of God remains in a tent. Like, David's like, man, you know where I started? I lived in caves for years. I was a shepherd boy, and here I am in a palace. Some of you can relate. You think to where you started. You think to the roots that you come from. And you go, wow, like, pinch myself. Where I am today is remarkable. And as part of that, David says, all that God's given me, and he's still living in a tent. Now, they knew God didn't live in the box and in the tent. It was the focal representative of their worship of God, who was the God of the universe, okay? But it represented that to them. And so David gets this idea. He's like, I'm going to build God a temple. I'm going to build my house out of my gratitude. That's what I'm going to do. But then God sends David a message, and he relays this. He's telling his son, 1 Chronicles 22, verses 7 to 8. I'll put that on screen next. And he says, David, he said, my son Solomon, I was ready to build a house for the name of the Lord. But the word of the Lord came to me and said, you've shed much blood and have fought many wars. You are not to build a house for my name. Your son Solomon will have the job. God said no to King David. Was it evil? Was it bad for people? No, it was a good thing David wanted. God said no. What do you do when through God's sovereign plans and the contingency of human decision making, the answer is no to something good you want? Is it a relationship you're wanting this year? Is it this school, not that one? Is it, I don't know what it is, but the answer is often no in life. What does David do? Does he decide, well, I'm an older man. This is the last thing I wanted to do to honor God, and he won't let me. I'm going to be bitter. No, he does what healthy people do, the next best thing. He moves on. And what he decides to do, instead of being discouraged, he does this amazing thing, and that's what sets up this passage, this teaching. Even though he's never going to see the temple, he decides, well, I'll do the next best thing. I'll raise all the money for it. I'll get all the carpenters and the artisans organized. I'll get all the materials for it so that when it comes time for the next king to build the temple, all he will have to do is say, let it be done, let it be so. And the temple will be built. It'll be ready. And so David spends the last years of his life preparing for the temple that he will never see. How about you and me? He spends these years about leaving a legacy now. That's what he's going to start doing. And how about you? Do you think about legacy? It's never too early. Adults over 60, I've met a few of you recently who said, we moved here to Huntersville because we're going to be near our kids and our grandkids. Dude, that's beautiful legacy stuff to build ballast into the soul of a grandchild and tell them how much God loves them and how much they matter to you. That's beautiful legacy stuff. Some of you think through ownership succession of an enterprise that you own or you've been part of. Some of you think about legacy. Oh my goodness, some of you. Just this year, you decided to participate in a legacy of rescuing a child through one of our orphanages in Asia, in northern India, rescuing a child without a future into a family, into a future, into God's family. So many of you are leaving beautiful legacies by how you give. And David here, he's all about legacy. How are you doing that? Chapter 29, 1 Chronicles, verse 1. Then King David said to the whole assembly, let's put this on screen. My son Solomon, the one whom God has chosen, is young and inexperienced. The task is great because this palatial structure is not for man, but for the Lord God. And listen to this, verse 2. OK, Can we put verse 2 on screen? With all my resources, I have provided for the temple of my God. Gold for the gold, silver for the silver. And in your Bible, it might say it a little differently, but it's because more literally what David is saying here is with all my ability to give, I've given to this project. In other words, for David, this isn't about a percentage giving. It's not about, well, I had this left over at the end of the month, so I kind of slipped it in there to help build the temple. This is about how much I think it'll take for God to be happy and for me to think of myself as a spiritual person. No. He says, I looked around at his king and everything that's my wealth personally, and I went in with a mindset, I want to give as much as I possibly can so it could be said of me, I gave with all my ability. And interesting, David's not embarrassed to talk about his generosity with the people of God, about giving resources to God's work in this world. And I remember being a pastor when I started. I was 31, 32 years old. I'm like, oh my gosh, talking about giving in front of people, that's so personal. Dude, I'm not embarrassed. I love to talk about generosity. I'm so happy to look at this passage of scripture today with you. You know why? Because I see the wreckage of people, friends, who are enslaved to debt. And it is sucking the plenitude and the capacity out of their life, emotionally and spiritually. I see singles, I see married people who spend up to the 100% mark of what they earn, and I see the stress in their eyes all day, every day. Everything's a stress when you live that way, and it makes me sad for people. And so I'm not embarrassed to talk about giving because it's God's antidote to stress. Because when you live the way that the book of Proverbs teaches, 80-10-10, first 10% goes to God's priorities, his kingdom work. Second 10% hooks your future self up, savings. And when you live on 80% at whatever your income level is, instead of the stress here, is here. I'm so happy when I see people discover you can live that way. That normally am I not embarrassed to talk about God's plan for generosity. I'm eager, just like David is here. The only reason I hesitate and I'm a little bit worried when I talk about giving and tithing here with you is the off chance that one of you might mistake this for a legalistic rule to keep God happy with me. That would break my heart. Because generosity is not something God wants from you. It's something he wants for you. God will never love you more or less than he does right now. And his gift of salvation through Jesus is free. We don't have to do anything. We don't need to give a penny or $1 million. He just gives it to you and he lavishes it. He loves you and he's happy with you. Generosity is his plan for you to have a joyful, abundant life and know there's meaning in your money and there's order in your home. It's his gift. And so David's not embarrassed to talk about it, his own generosity, and nor are we. We want the abundant life for one another. So, verse 2, he says, with all my resources I provided for the temple of my God, gold for the gold, silver for the silver. Verse 3, besides in my devotion to the temple of my God, I now give my personal treasures of gold and silver over and above everything I've provided for this holy temple. And in verses 4 and 5, he details the amounts, which one scholar has estimated is the equivalent of $17 billion worth of stuff out of his personal. And here's what's interesting. He says, yes, I drew from my wealth as king. I got that going for me. But I also dipped into my personal wealth because I wanted to be said I gave everything I could possibly give. And I think this is relevant for business owners, business leaders. He gave from his personal income. I think some of us could be tempted to fake ourselves out with generosity by skimming it off of net profit, when in fact, maybe We're just depressing wages and benefits of the beautiful people who work in our enterprise, as opposed to our giving personally costing us out of our income. But David's like, so I'm giving out of my king stuff, my business, I'm giving out of my personal. Like, I'm looking for a way to give. I'm not looking for just how much do I have to do so I feel like a spiritual person. This is awesome. Now, look down at the end of verse 5. He turns and speaks to the people, and he says, who's willing to consecrate themselves to the Lord today? He doesn't say who's willing to give a lot of money. It's because this is about the heart and the soul. He's like, who's setting your whole life apart for God's usage? Like for God's legacy of his kingdom stuff. Verse 6, then the leaders of families, the officers of the tribes of Israel, the commanders, thousands, hundreds, officials in charge of the king's work, they gave, what? Willingly. That reminds me of some people. A whole bunch of you all. It's just beautiful. This is just a reflect. I've chosen this passage today on purpose after what Mitch said. Like, y'all are beautiful at this. So many of you. They gave willingly. They gave toward the work of the temple, 5,000 talents and 10,000 darics of gold, silver, 18,000 talents of bronze, 100,000 talents of iron. My goodness, it goes on. Verse 8, any who had precious stones gave them to the treasury of the temple of the Lord in the custody of Nick Biancafiore. Nick is our accountant and bookkeeper here for 20 years now. He's so faithful. He's actually the accountant in charge of the whole Hornets arena uptown, and he does this for us. But back in the day, his name was Jehiel the Gershonite. There in verse 8. I'm going to start calling you that, Nick. Verse 9. This is beautiful. Verse 9. Let's go to the next screen. The people rejoiced at the willing response of their leaders, for they had given freely and wholeheartedly to the Lord. David the king, Mike and Mitch the pastors, the elders of Lake Forest rejoice greatly as we see the generosity of Lake Forest, folks. This is beautiful. You all are beautiful in your generosity, just the way the people of God were back in 1000 BC here. And what you see here in 1 Chronicles 29 is almost a feeding frenzy mentality that develops toward giving. People are like, well, man, they're not like, well, how much do I need to do to get in the game and feel like, okay, I'm part of the people of God? They're just like, how can I get in on this? What else do I have? How generous can I be to God's purposes in this world? And it's incredible. Even though most of them will never see it, it's going to be a legacy. And I've seen that here multiple times. And yet, I know there are people missing out. A lot of Americans miss out on this as a lifestyle. And instead live in an attitude of, well, how little could I give and still respect myself in the morning? How close can I get to greed without being greedy? Because I know almost nobody who really wants to be greedy. That does exist. But most of us don't want to be that. But like, but I'd like to know where the line is, and I'd like to be an inch behind it. And sometimes we think that way. And when we think that way, it's because we're confused. And we're not getting something that these guys in 1 Chronicles 29 got. It's we're confused because we think we're an owner. We think we're the owner. And so here's how we give. Okay, God, you get a little something. See you next week. Next week, maybe a little bit more if I'm still good on my bills and stuff. But really, it's mine. And you know, it sounds different ways. People will come to me and be like, hey, Pastor Mike, like tithing, man, isn't that like an Old Testament thing? Please, please, please say yes. And I'd be like, well, dude, New Testament, Jesus said, yeah, you Pharisees ought to do that. And then also love and justice. And New Testament teaches proportional, percentage, planned, regular giving of what we can willingly, joyfully give. Or somebody's like, Mike, do I tithe off the gross or the net? Do I give before taxes or after? I'm like, well, Angie and I decided we want God's blessing off the gross, not the net. And so that's what we do. But sometimes our questions and our thoughts about this can come from how little can I give and keep God happy with me? because we're looking at it like a legalistic contract or something, as opposed to a gift, a grace from God that orders our life and gives us joy and sets us free from the tyranny of stuff. Because that's a long way away from the attitude of, man, I want to max out my giving, give as much as I can. Awesome. And this group of people saw and embraced and recognized. Here's the bottom line today. I'll put this on screen. David and the people acted like stewards, not owners. They recognized that they were not owners at all, that they're stewards. An owner, it belongs to me. A steward, it's just on loan to see what I'll do with it. It's somebody else's. And when that mentality sunk in, that's when this group got into this giving frenzy. Like, what's my maximum level and capacity of giving? Not where's the line that I have to toe up to. Verses 10 to 11. Now, we know this because of the prayer that David prayed. This is so powerful. Verse 10, this is the point. He says, David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly, saying, "Praise to you, God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours." Would you say that bolded out part with me? For everything in heaven and earth is yours. Worshiping online, driving in your car, looking on your phone right now, say it with us, everybody together. For everything in heaven and earth is yours. They had this big wake-up call. Hey, I'm not an owner. Everything's God. I've got a little portion of it on loan to me for a short amount of time to use for God's purposes and my joy. And so they wanted to give as generously as they could because it all belongs to him anyway. Now he goes on, verses 11 and 12. And men, just specifically for a second. I think this is powerful because it's well known that masculinity has a different kind of attachment to our work, maybe than some femininity does. And so he says this, "Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Wealth and honor come from you." This is so powerful to me, men. David was a man, like a lot of men in this room. He gave his life and his heart to his occupation. He had risked his life numerous times for the nation of Israel. He lost a son for the nation, which was his occupation. He had lost other family members for his work. He had invested so much of his life into making Israel the people of God and getting them into the capital of Jerusalem. And at the end of his life, after he's invested all of his energy and his time, he's built it up, he's worked long hours, he's got gray hair and wrinkles, and he's looking at this kingdom that God has allowed David to develop. And he's saying, God, even though there's a lot of me in the product of my work, even though it's the result of a lot of my hard work, the truth is, it's yours. The kingdom is yours. You. What you have is because you've taken advantage of opportunities. The reason you've worked hard, you've leveraged opportunities and your abilities, you've made sacrifices. Many of you were afforded an education by a family that propped you up. But at the end of the day, if you and I are wise and smart, we look at my little kingdom, my career, my little house, my little cars, my little man toys in my garage, and say, Lord, yours is this little kingdom because everything comes from you. I am but a steward. Now, another pastor has his people do something that I'd like to ask you to do just because I like to make you uncomfortable every now and then. But would you raise your hands up in the air? Let's be charismatic Presbyterians for just a minute. That's not an oxymoron. Up in the balcony, I see you. Please raise your hands like you're on a roller coaster. Okay? And let's all say together, everything belongs to God. I want you to imagine your kingdom, everything. Keep your hands up. I want you to imagine your 401k. I want you to imagine your bank account. I want you to imagine your car that you came here in. I want you to imagine your favorite little chair that you settle into with your coffee in the morning. I want you to imagine where you live. I want you to imagine the clothes hanging in your closet. I want you to imagine those 55 pairs of shoes you have in that closet. And now let's say everything belongs to God. Everything belongs to God. That's the belief system of a steward. who activates it through the behavior of giving. And then God grooves the character trait of generosity, which overflows and blossoms into joy throughout a whole life. What a privilege that we get to steward everything that belongs to God. Because everything I have, if you took away everything that's been given to me, I'm a mannequin. That's all I am. Verse 14 says, let me put this on screen. Who am I? Who are my people? We should be able to give as generously as this. Everything comes. We've only given what comes from your hand, O Lord. Everything belongs to God. Everything comes from God. We're a steward who manages someone else's stuff. God's put on loan some stuff, some money, some talent, some time for a short period of time for you and me to use it. And a steward is someone, I'll put this on screen, who takes their cue from the owner to decide what to do with the stuff. And you know, when we live as a steward, not an owner, God's goals come first. And so, 20-somethings, now's the time. If you're in college, now's the time. With whatever income comes in, start living 80-10-10. First 10% goes to God's goals, kingdom stuff. How awesome is it that part of God's goals for this church is we will be planting some churches in the Middle East this year through all of our combined legacy giving. Dude, I want to be part of that. Just start now. And wherever you are, 10% goes to God's goals first. 10% to your future self. Hook that person up. And then live off of the 80%. Your 20s is the time to start. Because everything we have comes from God. And it all belongs to God. And all the time, God is about his big, huge, eternal, sovereign purposes in this world, redeeming all things and people to himself. We get to be part of it through our giving. And there's already enough money in the bank accounts of Christians in this country to feed the hungry, to house the homeless, to educate the ignorant, and to spread the good news of Jesus to every tribe and nation where Jesus is not yet known. It's there. And it's beautiful the way God is using you to do all of these things and more. It's just beautiful. And so here's the end. Just let me just be super practical. Number one, let's put this last screen up if we could. Number one, for those of you here at Lake Forest, like a whole butt ton of you who are tithing and giving the first 10% of your earnings to God's work in the world, will you rejoice greatly today? Just like go home and hook yourself up with an extra bowl of nachos. Just rejoice that you're living that way. I'm just so proud of you, and it's a joy to do that with you. This year, Angie, God has led Angie and I, will be giving 14% of our income, the bulk of it here, and then also to mission partners that we really believe in. For those of you who are not yet tithing, let's put this last screen up. Hey, I just invite, God wants this for you, not from you. It's very intentional we're doing this today. Start the 1% challenge. Grow your giving just by 1%. Everybody in my hearing can do that. Now, activate it by text or online. Activate it today as you talk to the Lord about it. Just grow it by 1% and do that the rest of the year. Or start the tithe challenge. Pastor Mitch is very famous for standing up here once a year and saying, hey, God promises that when you give the tithe, he will give back to you even more. And so Mitch says that if you go ahead and start the tithe challenge and you find that God doesn't bless you in return in non-material, immaterial ways, he will write a check back to you from his personal account. That's what he says. Guarantee. Would you stand and let's pray? Oh, God, you're so good. Everything comes from you. We thank you for our life. Oh, my goodness, here we are breathing. Our hearts pumping because you gave us life. We thank you. We thank you that you have given us Jesus so that we can know who you are, that you are love, and that you love us unconditionally. And we can live in that love every day because of a relationship with you by putting our faith in Jesus and then walking in the Holy Spirit to love others in your name. God, may we be those people who all week the stuff we're riding in on the lake, the stuff we're driving in, and the things we sit in, may we just be like, God, how can I be a steward of this? Even this is from you. Thank you. We want to live as stewards. Call us each to follow through. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's sing together to receive God's love for us and to express our love to him. Let's sing.
Old things have passed away. Your love has stayed the same. Your constant grace remains the cornerstone. For all that
wanna heal you, create light of the world, abandoned in darkness to die. And as you speak,
Spirit be yours, and may you steward those things well this week. Go in peace. Amen.